I'm looking forward to building this. Many of you that have been following the channel for a while now know that every single month I put out three different streaming builds at roughly $1,200, $1,600, and $2,000. And these are systems that handle both gaming and streaming simultaneously in one PC. So the guys over at Nerd or Die, they came to me with the idea. They said, why don't you actually build one of the streaming PCs that you recommend on your website every month? Test its performance in a live streaming environment. That way your audience can really understand how performant these builds are. We'll pay for it, and at the end of the video, you can give away the system to one of your viewers. I said, let's do it. So in this video, we're going to be going through the $1,200 AMD build that I've recommended this month. We're going to be putting it together, testing out exactly how it performs in a live streaming environment. So we'll be testing different bit rates and resolutions with both the X264 and the NVIDIA NVENC encoder, so you can see exactly how it performs. And at the end of the video, we're going to be giving it away. So let's start first by thanking the people that have made this whole thing possible, Nerd or Die. If you're in need of a stream design upgrade, Nerd or Die is the place to go. With dozens of different design styles for overlays, alerts, stinger transitions, event lists, starting soon scenes, Twitch panels, chat boxes, you name it, they've got it, and in a design that you and your viewers are going to love. Also, you can now get a whopping 15% off anything in store by using the link in the description with code GAMINGCAREERS at checkout. So $1,200 is a decent chunk of money. It's certainly not a cheap build. Although I name it my budget build, that is purely because this is a system that is going to be capable of gaming and streaming simultaneously. And we're talking about playing the latest games at really quite decent frame rates. Our CPU of choice is the Ryzen 5 3600X, a 6-core and 12-thread processor clocking in at 3.8 gigahertz with a boost of 4.4 gigahertz. Now, although in this build, I would recommend that we're going to be using NVENC, since we've chosen an NVIDIA graphics card, which we'll get to in just a second, to handle all of the encoding on the stream, this CPU with its core count and its thread count absolutely could use the X264 encoder. So we will also be testing that to see exactly how it performs. The reason we've chosen this CPU over an Intel variant at the moment is that AMD is just ahead in the value for money game. You're getting a much better processor for the around $200 that this costs compared to an Intel offering. The other nice thing about the 3600X is it comes included with a cooler, so we can save a little bit of money. As long as we're not doing a heavy overclock, we can get away with using the default cooler that comes as standard. For the motherboard, we have chosen an MSI X570 Gaming Plus motherboard. Now, they're not the most exciting part of a build, but you do need to ensure you're getting one that is compatible with your other components. Now, you could save yourself a bit of money and go for a B450 board, which will work with the AMD CPUs. The reason I've gone for an X570 chipset is just purely that you won't have to deal with anything like updating the BIOS to get it working with these nice new Ryzen CPUs. For memory, we're just going to be going with a 16 gigabyte kit of the recommended DDR4 speeds for Ryzen 3000 series, which is DDR4 3600. These are the Corsair Vengeance RAM sticks. I've used them in countless builds before. They don't have RGB or anything fancy. They're just some very fast, affordable, and reliable RAM. Now for storage, you'll definitely want to be running Windows and some key applications from an SSD in this build. And with a little bit more money in our budget, I'd recommend getting an M.2 drive. What's the difference between an M.2 drive and a traditional SSD, I hear you ask? Essentially, M.2 drives operate directly through the PCI Express interface, whereas traditional SSD drives use the SATA connection, which is a bit slower. So in short, the M.2 drive will be fast, like really fast. Since this is just a small M.2 drive that we're going to be using for Windows and some key applications, we've also paired it with a 2 terabyte Seagate Barracuda mechanical hard drive. For the case, we are going to be using the NZXT H510. It's a favorite of mine. It's actually the exact same case that I'm using in my own system back there. It's just $70, super easy to build in, and it's a very clean and minimalist look with a tempered glass side panel and a bottom shroud, and honestly, I love it. Now, cases are largely personal preference, so feel free to shop around for something you prefer. Absolutely, it's your own choice and your own PC, so just make sure that you're getting something that fits our ATX motherboard and the length of our graphics card. So graphics card wise, this is where we're going to be spending the lion's share of our budget, and rightfully so, as the graphics card is not only going to be doing most of the work when it comes to running our games at nice high frame rates, but it's also going to be responsible for encoding our stream by utilizing NVIDIA's newer NVENC encoder, which is found on their latest cards. So I've chosen the RTX 2070 Super, This is the Gigabyte WindForce edition, which comes in just shy of $500 and should be able to absolutely breeze through the latest games, even at higher resolutions like 1440p. Talking about boring parts of the build, the power supply I went for is a 600 watt 80 plus gold PSU from EVGA. Unfortunately, over here in the UK, no stores had the one I chose for this build in stock, so I had to get a 650 watt one, again from EVGA instead. But really the most important thing with a power supply is that it's a well-reviewed product from a trusted brand. This 650 watt one and the 600 watt one that I've actually recommended in this build are both semi-modular, so you don't have to tidy up all of those extra cables you don't need. And the cable's all black, so you don't have any of that horrible ketchup and mustard colored cables ruining the look of your lovely new PC. Okay, so PC build is done. You can probably hear the fans running in the background. So the next thing we need to do is head into the BIOS and actually make sure our memory is running at the right speed and install Windows and things like that. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna swap this one out with my actual computer so I can use the screens, mouse and keyboard and get everything set up and installed. Okay, Windows is now installed. We've got all the drivers up to date and all the programs that we're gonna need to actually test this system. And for that, I really want to simulate what a realistic streaming environment looks like. So not just running some benchmarking software, because that doesn't really help you guys decide if this is the right kind of system for you, for your streams. So we're gonna be using OBS Studio to stream 5 different games to Twitch. These 5 games have been specifically chosen to cover some different genres and some different struggles that a computer has with streaming. So some are more CPU intensive, some are more GPU intensive, so hopefully covering a wide range. Now, obviously, if I just used OBS Studio's game capture to stream these games to Twitch, that's still not really a very realistic streaming environment. So we have added a webcam. You can see up behind me the Logitech StreamCam I've got plugged in there. We've got a webcam border as well as a WebM transparent transition that we're going to be using to really spike our CPU usage whilst we're in game and in the tests. Now, in terms of actual tests that we'll be running for each of these games, we will be streaming to Twitch at 720p 60fps at both 3000 kilobits per second and 6000 kilobits per second, and then at 1080p 60fps at 6000 kilobits per second and 8000 kilobits per second. We'll also be performing all of these tests on both the X264 and the NVIDIA NVENC encoder, so you can really see the differences for this system in using the different encoder options. We'll be testing for the average FPS, the 1% lows and the 0.1% lows that we are achieving in game at these various different resolutions and bit rates, and also what percentage, if any, of frames are being missed or skipped due to rendering or encoding lag from OBS Studio. Remember, our aim here is to have 0% frames missed or skipped due to OBS Studio render or encoding lag while still being able to achieve a high frame rate in game for you actually to play on. All the games that we'll be testing are going to be running at 1080p and their maximum quality settings in game.
6.5 hours later.
Okay, so I have now finished running the tests streaming to Twitch, and in over 100 tests, over 6 hours of streaming to Twitch, we didn't get a single frame of encoding or rendering lag in OBS Studio, which kind of shocked me actually. So I actually ended up running some bonus tests in 1440p as well, just to push our system to the limits. So let's actually dive into the results, and we're gonna start with Rocket League. So at 720p, we can see the average FPS for both encoders and bit rates is sitting at around 250 FPS, with the only real difference being that NVENC doesn't suffer quite as low frame rates at the 0.1% lows. Still though, in general, very high frame rates while streaming with either encoder at 720p. At 1080p 60, we can see the X264 Fast suffers at both bit rates with lower average FPS and 1% lows. Whereas really there isn't a huge difference for NVENC between the 720p and 1080p streaming. Overall though, Rocket League streaming with either encoder at 1080p performs very well on this machine, and you should be seeing some seriously high frame rates in game. Next we have League of Legends, typically a game that suffers from big CPU spikes in those hectic team fights, and this is reflected in both the 720p and 1080p tests when we're using the X264 Fast encoder. Again, NVENC performs significantly better, especially when we're streaming at 1080p resolutions, where we average over 50 FPS higher frame rates when compared to X264 Fast. For Dota 2, we are using the Vulkan API. Like I mentioned, it's recently been added as a supported game capture mode in OBS Studio, And Dota 2 seems to be the game that has the biggest discrepancy between average FPS and 1% lows. Again, probably due to those hectic team fights where lots of action is happening on screen. We're starting to see a bit of a trend here that NVENC is definitely the way to go, as we expected, as once again we get better average frame rates, 1% and 0.1% lows when compared to X264 Fast. Next we have Apex Legends, probably one of the more challenging games to stream on a single PC setup. Here we can see some really impressive results from our $1,200 build, and this is one test where the difference between X264 and NVENC encoding is minimal. I'd assume this is probably due to how GPU hungry Apex is and the fact that we're using an uncapped frame rate. My usual suggestion for those wanting to stream games like Apex Legends is to cap the frame rate and run OBS Studio as administrator to ensure that there is some GPU resources left over for OBS. But still, we have no frames missed or skipped by OBS, so a very playable game while streaming at even 1080p. Maybe just lower a few in-game settings if you want to ensure that you're always playing at over 144 FPS. Finally, we have Valorant, a game that has been optimized and built from the ground up to be a very high-performing esports title. And wow, the frame rates we get here while streaming sure do reflect that. Averaging nearly 400 FPS at 720p, 6,000 kilobits per second with NVENC is just crazy. And you can see, even at 1080p when using NVENC, we're averaging nearly 300 FPS with the 1% lows at 170 FPS. So again, NVENC would definitely be my recommendation here for streaming Valorant at either resolution. Right, so as I mentioned, I was super impressed with just how well this system was performing while streaming games at 1080p and running them at 1080p. So I decided I would try and run some bonus tests, pushing the system a little bit harder by running the games at 1440p while streaming at 1080p using the NVENC encoder. But even at 1440p, we still couldn't get a single frame skipped or missed due to rendering or encoding lag in OBS Studio. You can see that we definitely took a hit on some of the frame rates that we are achieving in game, but still really some impressive frame rates by streaming at 1080p and running the game at 1440p. You can see that for games like Apex and Dota, you could definitely do with fine-tuning some of the in-game settings so that they're not all maxed out and bringing some more frames in-game. But even then, we're still getting a really stable 1080p, 60fps, 6,000 kilobits per second stream to Twitch. So my overall impressions are, wow, this $1,200 build is performing so much better than my expectations. I kind of thought it would be able to do most of the 1080p, 60fps games, but I thought it would struggle in games like Apex Legends to really achieve those high frame rates, but it absolutely hasn't. So it's kind of making me rethink how I price these builds, because originally this $1,200 build was the cheapest one that I recommended, but it's performing at kind of the level that I expected the middle build, which was the $1,600 build, to perform at. So it's making me think maybe this should be the middle build and I should do an even cheaper, maybe $800 budget build, utilizing some of those new AMD processors like the 3300X. In terms of encoder choice, kind of exactly as I expected when I was first designing the system, you really want to be using the NVENC encoder. You get better frame rates in game, your CPU isn't going to be working as hard, so fan noise is likely to be lower, and really we were comparing X264 Fast with NVENC here, and in tests really we've actually seen that NVENC compares more to X264 Medium, so you're probably getting better results as well. If you are following along and wanting to build the system yourself, a couple of points are that if you wanted to squeeze even more performance out of the price, you could probably spend between $30 and $60 on an aftermarket cooler and then actually overclock the system, because these CPUs are overclockable and you'd probably be able to get between 5 and 10% higher frame rates in game with a decent overclock. Also, I realize that there's some of you out there that love the RGB look of a system, and I didn't really take too much into account in terms of how this system looks. I just wanted to get as much performance out of the $1,200 budget as I could. So if you do want to have some RGB fans inside or RGB memory, you can definitely spend an extra $50 to $100 to get some RGBness on your components inside and make the system look more aesthetically pleasing. But like I said, I just wanted the most performance for the price. Right, so for the part that you've all been waiting for, how can you actually win this system in part of the giveaway? I've included a link at the top of the description as well as in the pinned comments that goes across to a tweet that I've just made of exactly how you can enter this competition. It's super simple, just follow the instructions. It's open worldwide, so any one of you guys can win it. And again, a massive thank you to the Nerd or Die guys for helping arrange this sponsored video and the giveaway. Thanks as always for watching. It was a bit of a long video to create, especially with all those tests of streaming to Twitch, but hopefully you found it useful. If you've reached this point in the video, I'd really appreciate if you gave the video a thumbs up. And as always, I'll catch you guys in the next video. Peace. My days, I need a haircut badly. When are the hairdressers gonna open? Last player.
they are standing.